Turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 17. We'll finish chapter 17 today. And then guess what? We'll go on to 18.
What?
That's kind of how that works. Just letting you plan ahead. Read ahead. One of the things I remember distinctly about not being a Christian was some of the weird things that Christians said. You know, they said things that I just didn't really understand. They didn't make sense to me. Things that we say sometimes that we don't even recognize that it sounds strange to those who are not Christians. You know, things like calling the God of heaven our Father. I remember as someone who didn't believe in God, didn't believe in Jesus, thought that was weird. I thought that was strange. It didn't make sense to me. I didn't understand it. Another one is that, you know, Jesus is living in our hearts. We say that. We teach our little kids, Jesus is living in your heart. And to someone who doesn't believe and someone who's not a Christian, that's kind of a strange thing to say. It doesn't make sense to us. What would that mean to a non-Christian? And as we say things like that, and as we try to explain and communicate the message of Jesus Christ, you know, we recognize that some people are curious about these things we talk about, and others are not. I can tell you, Kelly will tell you, that I was not curious about the things she was talking about. Matter of fact, I didn't want to hear about it. It didn't make sense to me, so I didn't want to hear about it. There's something going on inside of us as we're trying to communicate the message, just living this life. There's something going on inside of us, and there's something going on inside of them. There is a story. We all have stories, and as our stories interact or intersect with one another, it makes the message available, possible. And the better we understand the way the message is being received, the way that's interacting with those around us, the better able we are to communicate the message to others. God is writing a story. He's writing a story of Jesus Christ in our lives, through our lives. And he wants us to share that story with others. And today we're going to talk about one of the big reasons why he wants us to share that story. It's a story they need to hear, and they need to hear it now, not later. We're going to pray, and then we'll get into today's text. Heavenly Father, we do come. And Lord, before we get into this text, this message, which is so full of some of the deep things of God, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would do something inside of each of our hearts. And Lord, as I reflect upon the people that are sitting in this room, Lord, there are so many stories here, so many people. And some are coming with just really cool, exciting things in their lives. Others are coming with deep hurts and pains, with burdens that at this point in their life, they feel that they're just too heavy to bear. And Lord, everything in between. And so, Lord, I know that as we come to a time like this, we come as your family. There's so many different things going on here in our lives and in this community and in this world, so many that are sometimes confusing, sometimes difficult to just get our minds wrapped around. Lord, we need you right now, that you would minister to your people in a way that allows us to hear what you want to say to your church, that we put our stuff down for a minute, whatever it might be, whether it be the glorious things of life or the hard things of life, that you would help us to set those aside just for a minute, that we might sit at your feet and hear what you would say to your church. Because there's a message that's really important that you want to communicate today to me and through me. And I ask, Lord, that, Lord, you would help me to put myself aside, that this message would come through in such a way, Lord, that it would minister to the hearts of people that need to hear it. We thank you, Lord, for your grace, your mercy, and your love, and we lift it up to you now in Jesus' name. Amen. So thank you all for being here. For those of you who are watching online, God bless you. Hi, Mom. I just got really big points there for that. I know I found out in Indonesia that we have people watching from Indonesia every week, so thank you across the world for being a part of what we're doing here today. As we're going through this text, we remember that every person you interact with has a story. We all have stories. The story of our lives, the story of the history of our lives, the stuff that's going on in our lives, the stuff that has gone on in our lives. It's all part of our story. And if we want to be a part of the work of God in this world, which we should want that, right? Then part of how we engage, part of how we do that is we need to understand how our story interacts with their story. The better our stories interact, the better they line up, the better we're able to communicate the message. If I understand your story, I'm going to be better equipped to share the story that God is trying to communicate to you in a way that ministers to you, that affects you, that challenges you, whatever it might be, whatever it is that you need, I need to know how to speak to you in a language that you'll hear and understand and respond to. Here in Luke 17, and moving on from here, we are nearing the end of Jesus' public ministry. For about 3 years, at this point in the text, Jesus has been telling people the story of the kingdom of God. That's been his main message, has been the kingdom of God. And to illustrate that story, he has done just countless miracles as exclamation points and as illustrations of the message of the kingdom of God, that God's kingdom is real, and it is amazing, and it's powerful, and that God is real, and he has a message for people. Well, people have been amazed by his miracles, but most have struggled with the message. They either struggled with it or just misunderstood it. And it's no different today. People still struggle with the message of Jesus Christ. They still struggle with the idea and the concept of the kingdom of God. And this was especially true with religious people and those of Jesus' time. Verse 20 of Luke 17 says this, "And now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, 'The kingdom of God does not come with observation, nor will they say, see here or see there, for indeed the kingdom of God is within you.'" The Pharisees were a group of people during that time period, who considered themselves experts on the things of God, on the kingdom of God. They studied what we would refer to as the Old Testament, and not just the Old Testament. They had a whole just volumes of teachings about the Old Testament. And so they considered themselves experts on the kingdom of God and on the Messiah. They were waiting for this coming kingdom and this coming Messiah, the Savior that would come and deliver them, would set up the kingdom of God on this earth. And for 3 years, Jesus has been saying, the kingdom is here. In Mark 1:14, he says this, "Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, saying, 'The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" Jesus saying it's here. And so the Pharisees are saying, okay, but we don't see it. We don't see the kingdom. They were looking for a physical manifestation of the kingdom of God. And in their opinion, what that meant, in their view of reality, was what that meant was that the nation of Israel would be a blessed nation freed from the oppression of the Romans who were ruling over them at that time. That's what it meant to be the kingdom of God, to be at hand. They were looking for a political kingdom. To them, the kingdom was God's people, the Jews, in God's place, the land of Israel, and under God's ruler, the Messiah. That's what they were waiting for. That's what they were looking for. And to this day, religious Jews are waiting for that exact thing. But Jesus said he came to establish a different kingdom, a different kind of kingdom, a kingdom within. But what does that mean? That's one of those sayings that we say, and that you know, non-Christians look at it and say, well, but what does that mean? Well, a lot of Christians actually say that. What does that mean? I know some of you are thinking it. Just admit it. No, don't admit it. You can admit it to your neighbor next after the service. Simply, what it means is that someone who yields to God's authority and feels a sense of loyalty to God and identifies as one of God's people through Jesus Christ, obeying his commands. That's what it means to have the kingdom of God within you. Jesus came, when he came the first time, he didn't come to establish a physical kingdom. He came to establish something inside of us. And after saying that, you know, the reality is most of the people around him, that's not what they were looking for. The Pharisees weren't looking for that. And it's the reason why they didn't accept Jesus, because that's not what they wanted. You know, brothers and sisters, we need to understand something. You gotta be careful. You gotta be careful that you're not looking for the wrong Jesus. Sometimes people are looking for the wrong kind of Jesus, the wrong kind of God. And he's not gonna bend himself to your will to be what you want him to be. He is what he is, and we need to accept him for who he is. Even the disciples wanted this other Jesus. They wanted a different Messiah. They wanted a different Christ. Jesus tells the disciples something that they need to watch out for, and we also need to watch out for. Verse 22, then he said to the disciples, the days will come when you will desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you will not see it. And they will say to you, look here or look there. Do not go after them or follow them. For as the lightning that flashes out of one part under heaven shines to the other part under heaven, so also the Son of Man will be in his day. He says, in the future, you're going to wish that I was here with you, but I'm not going to be here. I'm going to be gone. In John 14, verse 27 and 28 says this, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard me say to you, I am going away and coming back to you. Jesus said to them, I'm going to go away, but I'm going to come back. But he says, when I come back, no one's going to have to announce my arrival. The whole world will know instantly when Jesus comes back. Every single person on earth, at the time that Jesus steps foot on this earth, they're going to know it. Wherever they are in the world, they're going to know instantly that he's come. And not only that he's come, they're going to know exactly what it means to them. Whether it's good news or bad news. And that's the way it's going to be. For some, it's going to be good news. Others, it's going to be bad news. And they will know that instantly. No one's going to tell them. You know, we live in a time, and it's been true throughout the generation, throughout the centuries, there have been people standing up and saying, I am the Messiah, right? I mean, David Koresh, remember David Koresh in Waco? He stood up and said, I am Jesus. I am the Messiah. And people believed him. I don't understand that. But people believed him. No one's going to have to announce it when Jesus comes back. Someone invites you to come see the Messiah, don't go. Don't go. Otherwise, you'll end up in a compound someplace. Never mind. I'm not going to go there. Hey, listen. Listen. The worse life gets, the worse this world gets, the more we will long to see Jesus. We will beg him to come. It's at that point we need to be careful. Because the greater our desire for his return grows within us, the chance of deception goes up higher. And we have to be careful. We have to know the truth so that we're not deceived. And the simple truth is, you won't have to look for Jesus when he comes back. Not that if you're a believer here today, you're going to have to worry about that. It's a whole other conversation. There's a ton of doctrine in this we're not getting to today. Don't be deceived. But then he says, before that happens, verse 25, but first he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation. And the Messiah, before he comes, must suffer. This is one of the reasons why the Pharisees had such a problem with Jesus. Turn in your Bibles to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53. The idea of a suffering Messiah, a suffering Savior, did not line up with their theology. Didn't line up with their doctrine. They were looking for a conquering king. They were looking for the second coming king. Not the first coming. They were looking for a savior, a messiah, a king who would drive out the enemies of God from the land of Israel and bring the people of Israel back into a place of prosperity and blessing like in the days of King David. That's what they were looking for. And they didn't understand that God's plan always included Jesus coming twice to this world. In his second coming, he will come as the king. And he will establish a physical kingdom on this earth. But Isaiah 53 is a prophecy about the first coming of the Messiah. I guess I'll turn there too. The whole chapter, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but the whole chapter talks about this. Verse 1. Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he, if you're reading in the New King James, notice that the he is capitalized, it's referring to the Messiah, shall grow up before him, that is God, as a tender plant, and as a root out of the dry ground. He has no form of comeliness, no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. This is all speaking of the Jewish people. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. By his stripes we are healed. All of us can claim verse 5 as a very personal exhortation to us about what Christ did for us. He died for our sins, took our punishment so that we wouldn't have to be punished by God. Whole chapter points to the first coming of Christ and to die for our sins. In other places, Psalm 22 is another place that describes that. There's other places as well describing that. Turn back to Luke 17. The Pharisees were looking for this different Messiah. The Messiah they were looking for was coming, but not until far in the future. And Jesus gives us two illustrations here of what the world will be like when Jesus does come back. Verse 26. And as it was in the days of Noah, so will be also in the days of the Son of Man, when the Son of Man comes back. They ate, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise, as it was also in the days of Lot, they ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even so, it will be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. The Bible tells us that these two men that are described here, Noah and Lot, were righteous men. In a generation that was marked by wickedness, in a culture that was marked by evil, both men were delivered by God from the judgment that he was bringing upon the world in Noah's case and Sodom and Gomorrah in Lot's case. Excuse me. Notice here that Jesus doesn't really address the evil of his of that generation. He comments on what they were doing. They were just doing everyday, natural, normal things of life when judgment fell. It's not that they were ignorant that something was coming. It's not they were not ignorant that judgment was coming. The problem is they were indifferent to it. And what Jesus is saying here is that when he comes again, the world's going to be in that same place. They're going to be doing the same things. They're going to be eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. They're going to be building. They're going to be buying and selling. They're going to be going about normal activities, normal stuff, indifferent to the reality that God exists and that judgment is coming. Speaking of the Holy Spirit, Jesus said in John 16:8, and when he comes, the Holy Spirit comes, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. The world, no one in this world will be able to stand before God and said, why didn't you warn us? Why didn't you tell us that judgment was coming? Because the Holy Spirit's been doing it since men and women first started sinning. And Jesus comes to establish his physical kingdom on the earth. People will be indifferent toward God, his word, and his will. Can we maybe look around this world and suggest that that's exactly what we see in this world around us? We often even say that we are living as it was in the days of Noah and or Lot. Judgment is coming to this world. It's coming to this world because of its sin and its rejection of Jesus Christ. And the longer we're in this world, the more we see, man, oh man, it deserves it. Some of the things, and I hate to even say this. I mean, you know, I was going to Indonesia, when I went to Indonesia, I was almost expecting people to ask me questions about what is going on in America right now. Man, some of the laws that our states and government are passing are just absolutely an abomination before God. How is it that God hasn't judged us already? It's just the grace of God. It's just his grace, his mercy, his patience. But understand something, his patience is not eternal. When it does happen, this world is going to be going on business as usual, indifferent to the reality that judgment is coming. It's a little unclear about who verses 31 through 33 are addressed to. Let's read those. Verse 31, in that day, he who is on the housetop and his goods are in the house, let him not come down and take them away. And likewise, the one who is in the field, let him not turn back. Remember Lot's wife. Whoever seeks to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses life will preserve it. It's very similar to something that Jesus said in Mark 13, verses 14 and 15. So when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing where it ought not, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not go down into the house, nor enter to take anything out of the house. It goes on as you read through that section, kind of similar, very similar to the text in Luke. And the abomination of desolation, as we understand that, is referring to a statue that's going to be built, going to be created, and then it's put into the rebuilt Jewish temple. And as we understand the scriptures, it's going to be at the halfway point of the tribulation when the Antichrist stands up and declares himself as God and demands to be worshipped by the whole world. And Jesus says, at that point, don't just run, turn and run. In verse 32, I believe, is a challenge for us as modern Christians, modern believers. When God saved Lot, as you read through that account, what it says to us is that Lot hesitated to do what God told him to do, which was to leave Sodom, to take his family and go, to get out of Sodom, because God was going to destroy it. And ultimately, the angels had to grab Lot and his wife and his two daughters by the hands and drag them out of Sodom before God poured out his judgment upon Sodom. But as they were, before they did that, they were warned, do not look back. Don't look back. Well, if you've read the account, you know what happened. Lot's wife looked back. And she was turned into a pillar of salt. She couldn't imagine her life without the things in Sodom. God had said, it's all going to be destroyed. And she could not imagine her life apart from those things. She could not imagine where God was leading her. She could not see herself as going someplace better with God than what she had in wicked, evil Sodom. I think there's a message there for us as the modern church, as the modern Christians, as people living in a culture that loves stuff, right? Do we not love stuff in this culture? I love stuff. I have lots of stuff. I get more all the time. Ask Kelly. I'm always getting more stuff. We have to be so careful that those things don't become what we're about. We've got to remember that there is a warning here not to get too attached to the things of this world. The Apostle Peter addresses that very issue. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10. The day of the Lord, again, the same time period, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works in it will be burned up. What does that mean? It's all going to be burned up, right? Take it literally. It's all going to be destroyed. What? Look around. All of this stuff, all of this beautiful building, all the nice scenery out there, it's all going to get burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, not just burned up, dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God? Because all these things, how should we live? You know, if all of this stuff's going to be burned up, how should we treat it? As if it's all going to get burned up. Enjoy it. Use it. But do not attach any eternal value to it. Lot's wife saw her whole life bound up in the things in Sodom. Could not see her life where God was leading. God is taking you someplace. You know that, right, Christian? You know where he's taking you, right? Somebody tell me where God's taking us. Heaven! Come on, is that not a great thing, right? I mean, isn't it amazing? And we don't know very much about heaven, but I can promise you, it's pretty heavenly, right? I mean, there are no human words to describe the glory of heaven, what it's going to be like to be in the very presence of God and absent from sin. No human has experienced that in this life. Yet we will. And that's where our heart should be. That's where our attention should be. That's where our affection should be, is focused on those things and not caught up in the things of this life. These things are all going to burn up. And if you're talking about stuff, it's all going to wear out. Right? I mean, how long does it take before your computer is useless? Come on. I'm struggling with that right now. Come on. Why can't they even expect these things to last more than a week? The day is coming. The day is coming when all this stuff that we're so attached to, that we put so much energy into, so much of our life into, it's all gonna go away. It's all gonna burn up. attached with that is the reality that God is going to judge the wicked of this world. And the more I grow in my faith, the more that sickens me. It grieves my heart to imagine it. Now, I look around this world and I say, okay, I'm beginning to understand just how it needs it. It deserves it. But there's also this reality building up inside of me on what that's going to cost people. And I can't just accept that, even though I'm understanding it better and better how right it is. Judgment's coming to those who are not God's people. The question I'm asked pretty regularly is, how can you tell if someone is really saved? And I give a really spiritual answer every time. I don't know. I can't tell. I can't absolutely tell you with any certainty if someone else is saved. I can look at some of the signs. I can give you an idea. I can say, yeah, probably. I can't tell you with absolute certainty, but God can. God knows. And that's what these next verses teach us. Verse 34. I tell you, in that night, there will be two men in one bed. The one will be taken and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding together. The one will be taken and the other left. Two men will be in the field. The one will be taken and the other left. And they answered and said to him, "Where, Lord?" So he said to them, "Wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together." Now, this might be pointing to the rapture of the church, of true believers. But the context of this section has been associated with judgment at Christ's second coming. And so it's probably a better interpretation to point to connect this with the separation of the sheep and the goats in Matthew 25. The rapture is going to ultimately be the same thing. Jesus knows whose are his, and at the rapture, only his people are going in the rapture. But the sense of this context might be Matthew 25, where it says at Christ's coming, there are going to be people in this world that from the outside, you can't tell whether they're believers or not. You can't tell whether they're God's people or not. They're going to be in the same place doing the same thing. They're going to, from the outside, they're going to look the same. But one will be taken into judgment and the other will be left to enter into the millennial kingdom. Jesus is going to sort them out. And he knows perfectly what's in every person's heart. God knows what's in the heart. God knows those are who are his people and those who are not. The exhortation to us is, we may not know, but you better know your own heart. You better know whether or not you have Jesus Christ or not. Because judgment's coming. That separation is coming. And you can't wait until that moment to decide. If you've repented of your sins and accepted Christ's sacrifice for your sins, then the kingdom of God is within you. And only those, here's the key, only those who have the kingdom of God in you right now will be invited and allowed into the kingdom of God forever. You can't decide that later. Judgment is coming to this world. And as a believer, I don't fear God's judgment. I don't have a lick of fear about God's judgment. Why? Because Jesus took my judgment on the cross. I'm free of judgment. And just as God delivered Noah and Lot before the judgment fell upon the world and or Sodom, he will deliver me and all other true believers out of the judgment that is coming to this world. Hey, listen, brothers and sisters, I don't like talking about judgment. I don't like talking about it because there are not words to really understand what it's going to be like when that finally happens. But we need to talk about it. We need to understand it. It is coming. I'm thankful that I'm not going to be here when it's happening. But there are people I know who will be. And that bothers me. Question, how should we live? How should we live if these things are true? How should we live if judgment really is coming to this world? How should we live with the reality that it could happen any moment? God is writing a story in your life, the story of Jesus Christ and the kingdom of God. He's writing that in your life right now. I'm going to end this message on time. Woohoo! With three quick things in the next 40 or 50 minutes. First one, live in the kingdom now. Now. Remember Lot's wife. That if you forget everything else I say, remember Lot's wife. She clung to the things of this world, and it cost her. And the same thing is true of us. Don't cling to the things of this world. Point one has three points, subpoints. I got about 29 of those to go. So, no, I don't. Just kidding. First one, how do you live in God's kingdom now? First, you must be one of God's people. To live in God's kingdom, you got to be one of God's people. As Christians, as believers, or as people today, the way we become one of God's people is we repent of our sins and we receive Jesus Christ as our Savior. That's how you become. John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you want to be one of God's people, you have to do it through Jesus Christ. And he calls us to repent of our sins. Second thing, God's place. You've got to give God his rightful place in your heart. And that means that your highest affection and desire needs to be God. And brothers and sisters, I know this world is doing everything it can to get your affection and desires turned on something else besides God. That's the way the world works. That's the system of the devil. He is working to affect, to change, to draw our affections away from God and put them on other things, that we would love anything other than him. And we don't even have to turn all the way from him. He just wants us to change our affection just a little bit, just love God a little bit less. Put it on something else. Listen, that we are called to him first and foremost. Now I'm also called to love my wife and to love my children, my grandkids, but they must always take a second place to God. He deserves my highest affections and my deepest desire. Third, God's rule. We have to turn over the authority of our lives to God. Let him be God. Live in the kingdom now. Second thing, do God's will today. The way we prove to the rest of this world that the kingdom of God is real is to do his will. And not later, today. If you know what God's will is, he revealed it to you so that you could do it. Third, finally, bring God's kingdom to others. Judgment is coming to this world. Maybe soon. And most of the world is indifferent to that reality. They're indifferent. Most people are just doing their normal life. They don't care about God. They don't care about the things of God. They don't care about the word of God. They don't care about his desire for their life. They don't care about the fact that he is really bothered by the fact that they're going to be separated from him for all eternity. They don't care about those things. They're absolutely indifferent to all of those things about God. God's people doing God's will are going to try to shake some of them from their indifference. That's what we're called to do, to try just to wake some of them up. We're not going to get to them all, but if we get just one, to wake up from the indifference, to wake up and recognize there is a God in heaven who loves them so much that he would send his own son to die for their sins. How do we do that? How do we shake some from their indifference? Well, the Bible tells us we do it through love, good works, and sharing of the gospel. Some of you may be called to share the gospel message in a practical, way, telling them the truth of Jesus Christ. Others, it's through acts of love. Others, it's going to be good works of some kind. God is going to use you some way, the way he made you, and it's up to you to figure out how he made you and do it. As a believer in Jesus Christ, it's very comforting to me that I am already living in the reality of the kingdom of God in my life. I'm as we go through this wicked world and bad things are happening either in our lives or around our lives, I can go boldly through this world, recognizing that I have a different destination. I have already been determined to go to heaven. And as my faith grows, I become bolder at sharing the truth with those who are indifferent to it. And some may be even antagonistic to it. Though, personally, I don't waste much time with people who are antagonistic toward the truth. God would call you to talk to those who might respond. If someone's indifferent to the coming judgment, they need to hear the truth. And who are they going to hear it from if they don't hear it from us? My desire, and one of the reasons that motivates me to do what I do, is that I have come to love my God. I've come to love the way that he loves me. I've come to love the way that he loves those around me. And I want other people to experience that. You couple that with the reality that there's a future coming that is too horrible to actually express in words, coming to those who do not know that love. And so I'm going to share. I'm going to teach. I'm going to minister. I'm going to serve. And I'm going to do it with as much of my energy and passion as I possibly can for as long as I can to as many as I can. And I'm going to encourage as many of you to do that as I can as well. Amen? Amen? Let's live the story that God has given us with passion and boldness. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your people. Lord, as we go through this life and we go through this world and it sometimes is filled with darkness and pain and suffering and trials and tribulation, Lord, and we come across those people who are indifferent to the truth, Lord God, it's sometimes hard for us to even respond to them. We want to stay away from them. We want to avoid them because it might be easier for us if we do that. But Lord, our very reason for being here in this world after we're saved is to share the love that you've given us with others in a way that might draw them out of the indifference that we were living in and walking in, that they might know the truth and be saved. And so I pray for these, your people. We've got a heart to live lives that are different, to allow you to write that story inside of them, inside of me, in such a way that it comes out in the way that I interact with other people's stories. Lord, there are people whose stories, they're going to end badly. They're going to end in eternal torment. And Lord God, that's not what you created any of us for. So I pray, Lord, that you would help each of us to be a part of the work that you've called us to. And that is to share the story of Jesus Christ, the one you're writing in each of our lives. Just to share our story. The story of Jesus alive in our hearts. That just, maybe even just one, will hear that. And their indifference will be washed away with the overwhelming love of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray, Lord, for each of us, Lord, that we would humble ourselves before you and allow you to write the story you want to write in our hearts. And that you would give us the boldness to share that story with others. And Lord, if there's someone here who has never allowed you to start that process, they've never repented of their sins and accepted you as their Savior, Jesus, I pray, Lord, that you would do a work in their hearts right this very moment. Help them to recognize that eternity separated from you is a really long time, and that you desire not separation, but intimacy. And so I pray that they would humble themselves before you. They would repent of their sins. They would just admit before you, God, that they have sinned and deserve the judgment that's coming to this world. And then receive the hope of forgiveness of sins, to receive that freedom from the guilt of our past. And then have the hope of heaven written firmly in their hearts. Lord God, I pray, Lord, if there's even just one here, or one listening to this or watching this message, that would hear that, that they would just pause and pray and ask for your forgiveness and ask for you to come in and to live inside of them. They may not understand it. They don't need to understand it. You'll teach them along the way. I pray, Lord, for your grace, your mercy, your love. I pray for those who are here today with heavy hearts, that you would encourage them and strengthen them. I pray for those who've experienced some amount of conviction from this message, Lord, that you would lead them toward that freedom that comes through obedience to your will and ways. And I pray for all of us, Lord God, the boldness to go forward from this place and to share the truth of Jesus Christ with others. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for your people, and I thank you for what you're going to do in and through this little church. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen, and God bless you all.